So in my previous presentation, we wired a couple of one-way switches independently controlling two different lights. And we suggested perhaps that's office number one, one-way switch light, office number two, one-way switch light. And now we're going to just quickly look at the terminations within the switch and the skirted baton lamp holder, just to make sure we get those connections absolutely correct for me. So we're now not got solid cables, of which we've been using extensively in our lighting circuits up until this point, in PVC, PVC twin and CPC cables. As we're now in PVC singles, we've got stranded copper conductor. So I need to make sure that we make a lovely connection both at the switches and at the skirted baton lamp holders. So in this presentation, we're going to look at those terminations. So we'll start off with my CPCs. As always, we need to make sure they go beyond the box between 50 and 70 mil. So we've got a nice conductor length. So just trim those back. We're going to take our knife to remove the outside insulation around the conductors. I know I've taken a lot of stick for this on YouTube. We are early stages of learning. We're only been with 14, 15 weeks. We're trying to get hand skills, so therefore we're going to use a knife. We're not at the stage yet where we're using any mechanical wire strippers. We want to learn those basic hand skills. So I'm going to strip it back quite long at this stage. So score around with my knife, take my pliers and remove the insulation. And that is considerably longer than I'm going to need it. However, for this technique, I need to make sure that I can trim it back. So I'm going to twist it super tight. Most of my learners have already stopped. I'm still going. Still going. Still going. And then I'm going to trim it back. I need it to be about 11 mil. Trim it back. And then again, just curl the end over. So we're going to connect these into an Inshore style maintenance-free connector, the ones with the lever arms at the top. So that's what we're going to put in here in the back of the box. Let's take the second CPC. Again, remove considerably more of the insulation than we need to remove. Lengthwise, take it off. And once again, twist. Again, keep going, keep going. So we're nice and super tight, and then trim it back to about 11 mil. And then turn the end back again. Take my maintenance free in this style Inshore. Wago make an identical one with the lever arm. So we're going to pull both arms up and position our conductors in like so. Push them into the connector and arm down into the connector. Arm down, just give it a tug. Yep, so our two CPCs are in a maintenance free connector held in the back of the box. Not needed to be connected to the box itself because it's plastic. Not needed to be connected to the switch as well because it's plastic. So neither of them are an exposed conductive part, but they are there in case the customer changes it, say for a metal fronted light switch. The CPCs are present to be connected to the exposed conductive part then. Let's move on to the line and switching line conductors next. So next I'm going to connect into the back of my one-way switch. I've got common and L1. There's only one way of turning the light on, so we're going to use a one-way switch. I've got two conductors here that are permanent lines, the one coming in from the consumer's unit and the one that loops off to the second office with a permanent line connection, so that will go in common. And I've got my switching line one that goes up to my light fitting, which will go into L1. So let's terminate the switching line conductor first, making sure it's 50 to 70 mil longer than the box. Trim it back. Again, take my knife. This time this is going to be doubled over, so I might need slightly more of the insulation around the conductors removing. Okay, so it's super long again, and I'm going to twist it tight. Important to keep going. So, still going. Okay, so my conductors are nice and tightly twisted. I'm going to double this one over because there is only one conductor going into the L1 termination, so it can be doubled over. It will fit in there. So trim it back. Twist again, and now I'm going to double it over. So we're looking for a perfect connection that has no copper strands spraying out, so it's nice and solid for when it goes into the connection for L1. Let's do that next. Goes firmly into the connection, and we should have no copper showing, and we should be fully inserted before we tighten up the conductor itself. It's quite a tight fit, but it does go in if you connect it correctly. Okay, so connection for L1's done and it's doubled over. We can see that it's going to be a struggle to do anything other than single terminations where we have two connections in the size of the hole in this style of switch. So when we go on to do the common connections, we're only going to have them singly into here and not doubled over. So let's do that next. So once again, now just take my two cables, which are my permanent line connections that are going to go into the common, making sure 50 to 70 mil longer than the box before trimming them back. Taking my knife, remove slightly more than I need for this twisting purposes of the insulation. And we go through the process again. This time we're not going to double it over, but we are going to make sure it's a nice solid connection that we're screwing into. So twist it tight. Remember, don't give up yet. Nice and tight on the twisting. Trim it back to the required length. Retwist the end again. Repeat the process for the second one. Press quite firm with your knife, all the way around. And we go and twist again. Important that we get this twisting done correctly, that they don't spray out and become weak when they connect into the switch itself. Trim it back. And twist again. So I've got my two conductors nice and tightly twisted, ready to go in. Can't double them over, I won't get them in if one was doubled and one was single, so they're both going to have to go in singly, and these are going into the common connection of the switch. It'll be tricky to get them to go into the hole itself. They've gone all the way in, so we can now tighten it up. Okay, so we've now got connected our switching line into L1 and our permanent line coming in and the permanent line going out into the common connection of the switch. We've made a nice twist and tight terminations for the conductors themselves, and we're ready now that we can screw that back. But remember, we've got testing first, so it'd be worth leaving it off before we actually screw it back for the final insulation resistance test. So for continuity, we'll leave it off. Insulation resistance test will go on. So we're ready to move now to the skirted batten lamp holder. So in order to get to the screws for these terminations here, it's quite tricky to do it. You're at a slight angle if you do not dissemble the skirted batten lamp holders. So I'm going to unscrew the straight skirt and its supporting ring so I can actually get straight at the connections that are here. We've got one here and one here, which will be either line, switching line or neutral, doesn't matter which, and this one here will be switching line or neutral. The reason being, it's a bayonet cap lamp holder, the pins have no polarity, so it won't matter if I choose that one as the neutral and that one as the switching line, or vice versa. And the back section here, the back one is the connection for the circuit protective conductor. Be careful if you're using Edison screw style lamp holders that you actually polaritize them, so there'll be only one pin in the center on a Edison screw, which will be the line, and the screwed part will be the neutral for the second one. But we've got a bayonet cap one and we're comfortable with these in my workshop. We know it has no polarity, so it doesn't matter which one's a switching line and which one's neutral, but the CPC is important we get it in the right termination. Let's make these connections next. So exactly the same as the switch, when we're making the connections in our straight skirted batten lamp holder, where there is two cables, so we've got two neutrals and we've got two circuit protective conductors, the insulation will be removed, twisted tight and singled into the actual terminations themselves. Where we've got only the one switching line conductor, we will obviously strip it back, twist it super tight and double it over for the connections within the actual batten lamp holder itself. So let's speed that up maybe so you can see these connections going in. Just be aware, where there's only one, it'll be doubled, where there's two, they'll be singled, using the same method as we use when connecting the actual switch itself. So let's do that next. So we've made our connections. It didn't matter which side we used as for the two neutrals, and we've got the other side being used for the switching line connection, because as we said before, it's a bayonet cap lamp holder, and our CPCs are connected into the back terminations here. No copper showing, nice and tight. The singled one's doubled over, the two CPCs are singular, and the two neutrals are singular for our connections into our accessory, remembering to twist them super tight, trim them back, retwist, and maybe double if needed, if there's only one in a hole, or single if there's more than one going into another termination holes. So we just need to rebuild our batten lamp holder. So our straight scale batten lamp holder, plate on first, followed by supporting ring, making sure you don't cross thread it, should go up nice and easily, followed by the straight skirt. Oops. Batten lamp holder now is ready to be secured back into position. So we've terminated both a one gang one way switch and a straight skirted batten lamp holder, this time in PVC singles, making sure our conductors are tightly twisted together before termination and making the decision whether they are singled or doubled over, depending on how many are going into each hole. I hope this video has been some help.